Well, hello again. This is Larry. My name is Larry Foltz. I'm one of the shepherds here. And we're going to be talking to you today about the second part of chapter 8 of Daniel. Will you just pray with me for a second? Oh God, thank you for your word. Thank you for how you've given to us so much information that helps us to know about what we should look for in the future. So help me as I talk about this with these men today. They'll be able to understand, comprehend, and we'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. In chapter 8, verses 1 through 14, Daniel talks about this second vision that he had was like the first vision that he had in chapter 7. The difference is in chapter 7, there are four world empires. In this, there's only two world empires. But he gives more detail about these two world empires, which we know to be the Medes and the Persians and the Grecian Empire, and spells it out more in detail. So it's like the old black and white picture in chapter 7, and it's that full-blown color picture in chapter 8 of these two nations, these two empires. So in verse 15, Daniel says, I saw a man. We don't know who that man was, but it was probably God or the incarnate Jesus, or Jesus before his incarnation. Because whoever that man was had authority over the angels. And I would suspect that that's going to be either God or Jesus. Because he tells Gabriel, the archangel, to describe and declare to Daniel what he wants him to know about the interpretation of the first part of chapter 8. One of the great things I love about God's word is that when God gives a prophecy, normally he will answer what that means. He will give you a depiction of what he's talking about and clarification of that prophecy. So he doesn't disappoint us. And in chapter 8, beginning with verse 15, God begins to give to Gabriel the message that he wants Daniel to understand. Now, this must have really been important, because this is now the third time that God has indicated and communicated to Daniel about these world empires. First, it was Nebuchadnezzar's dream in chapter 2. Second, it was Daniel's dream in chapter 7. And thirdly, it was Daniel's vision in chapter 8. So now we have these three times that God is communicating what he wants us to know about the future world empires. So it's none other than Gabriel himself who now gives to Daniel the interpretation of the vision that he had. God didn't want any mistakes. He didn't send just an angel. He sent Gabriel. Gabriel is the first time, this is the first time, that Gabriel appears in the Bible. He appears again when he speaks to Zechariah, telling him about the birth of his son, John the Baptist, and then he comes again to the Virgin Mary and declares that she will have a child whose name will be Jesus. So these are three times that we see Gabriel on the scene, and there's two other times when he appears to Daniel. Verse 20 says that, and I want us to move on to verse 20, because we're going to skip a little bit in between there, because I'm going to come back at the end and talk about it. So let's move to verse 20 in chapter 8. The ram which you saw having the two horns, they are the kings of Media and Persia. There it is. No questions, no need to look any further, to study any further. God gives to us exactly who these nations are. Now, Keep in mind, when Daniel wrote this, the Medes and the Persians were nobody. They were a poor little group of people. They were no power whatsoever. And yet, Daniel's writing about that's the next great power after Babylon that's going to come in the world scene. So, in verse 20, he says, it's a ram. It wasn't a stretch to use the ram as a representation of this empire, because actually the ram was the national symbol of Persia. Rams were stamped on Persian coins as well on the headdress of Persian emperors. So the ram was indicative of the Persian and the Medes empire. Now, Daniel had no way of knowing that. Only God could communicate that. And so if you weren't certain about the authority of the Word of God, there should be no question when you realize that God is giving to Daniel a message, a prophecy, an insight into what would happen future down the road. So in verse 21, it says, the male goat is the kingdom of Greece. That's that he-goat in the first part of chapter 8. So the ram, the Medes and the Persians, the he-goat, the Grecian Empire. Once again, there should be no question. Once again, there should be no reason to even study further who these countries, these empires are, because Gabriel, of none other than Gabriel, the archangel, gives to us who they are. And that horn between the eyes of that he-goat, that great horn, of course, as we said in the last lesson, is Alexander the Great. Interestingly enough, you will be surprised by this, the goat was the emblem of the Grecian Empire. In fact, Alexander's own son was named Agus, which means son of the goat. Can you believe it? Here's an empire way down the road. Daniel never knew existed. The Greeks were just a poor little group of people, no world dominance of whatsoever. And Daniel writes about them as being a world power. In fact, this ram, or this goat, is so powerful that he comes on the scene so suddenly that he just takes everybody by surprise in the world. From ancient to history, the goat was a common representation of the Greek Empire. And across the surface of the whole world, without touching the ground, this prophetic description of the male goat was proved to be accurate. It rose from the west of previous empires. It came with great speed without touching the ground. It had a notable ruler, Alexander the Great. It had a famous war with the Medes and Persians. In fact, the greatest wars fought in history, some of the bloodiest, or against the Medes and Persians and the Greeks. The Greek Empire conquered the Medes. And the reign of the noble ruler of the Greek Empire was suddenly cut short. That large horn was broken. Daniel saw that here in chapter 8, long before it ever happened. At the end, as I said in the last lesson, at the end of Alexander the Great's rulership, four generals took over different parts of the world. Cassander ruled over Greece and its region. Lysimachus ruled over Asia Minor. Seleucus ruled over Syria and Israel. And Ptolemy ruled over Egypt. Now, it says in verse 23, 24, and 25, it gives a narrative of a leader that comes at the end of this Grecian rule. It was not one of these generals, but it was a man who took control of Jerusalem was control of the area of Jerusalem by force in the latter time of this kingdom, Daniel says in verse 23, when the transgressors have reached their fullness. In other words, when Israel has transgressed against God in such a form that God feels that he must do something to bring Israel back to covenant with him, a king shall arise, Daniel says. Now, here again, Daniel has no idea who this king is. He has no idea what's going to happen except what God communicates to him. He'll have fierce features, Daniel says. He understands sinister schemes. Well, these fierce features, history lets us know that Antiochus Epiphanes was known for his cruel brutality. I told you in the last lesson that over 100,000 Jews were killed as a result of the brutality of Antiochus. And here's something that I want you to think about. And that is that sometimes prophecy has dual fulfillments. There is a partial fulfillment, a literal fulfillment, a typical fulfillment. And this is what's happening with this story of Antiochus Epiphanes, and that's why God wanted to communicate this to Daniel. Because what happened with Antiochus Epiphanes back in this time, in 167, I think it was, in December B.C., before Christ, is going to happen again under a man with the same kind of behavior and character as Antiochus Epiphanes, and we know him as the Antichrist. So the Antiochus Epiphanes is nothing more than a forerunner of the Antichrist. So, keeping that in mind, let's find out what he does, Antiochus, and we will have a pretty good idea of what the Antichrist will all be about. He understands sinister schemes. Antiochus was known for his cunning and smooth tongue. The Antichrist will strike a covenant with Israel to the point where Israel will believe that he is their friend. Revelation says he'll come in riding on a horse with a bow, but no arrows. So he'll come in with strength, but he has no ammunition. And so Israel will believe that he has come through his smooth talk to be a friend to Israel. His power, Daniel says, will be mighty, but not by his own power. It wasn't by the power that Antiochus had, it was by the power of Satan, that Satan gave to Antiochus Epiphanes to be able to do what he did. The power of the Antichrist will be coming from Satan. Just as there is a glorious Holy Trinity, there will be an unholy Trinity. The false prophet, Satan, and the Antichrist. He shall destroy fearfully. Well, and he'll prosper and he'll thrive. Antiochus Epiphanes looked like a total world success. The coming of the Antichrist will look like a complete winner. And that's why all the world will flock to him. He will be the savior of the universe until God topples his reign. Daniel says he'll destroy the mighty and the holy people. We know that. We also know that the Antichrist is going to destroy God's holy people. He shall seize a cause deceit to prosper. That's already happening today. But what the Antichrist, Antioch, and Antiochus Epiphanes in the past are marked by deceit. The lawless one is coming, the Bible says. And according to the working of Satan with all power, signs and lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish. According to 2 Corinthians chapter 2. And he says he'll exalt himself in his heart. Verse 25, part B. He'll exalt himself, and that's exactly what Antiochus Epiphanes did. He set himself to be the prince of the host of the heavens, and that's exactly what the Antichrist is going to do. He is going to be an anti-Christ. What Christ was, the Savior, the Deliverer to the Jews as a spiritual Savior, the Antichrist will be a physical Savior to the world. His title on the coins was Theos Epiphanes, meaning God is manifested. The Antichrist is going to show himself that he is God, according to Paul in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4, that he sets himself as God in the temple of God, the Bible says. So let's move on, and let's go back now to verse 19, because I think this is critical. Because there's a lot of confusion over what's happened in relationship to Antiochus Epiphanes and the sacrifice of the pig on the altar, because the Bible says that the Antichrist is going to do that. So there are some people who believe that Antiochus Epiphanes was the Antichrist. And that prophecy that took place then is the prophecy that John talks about in the book of Revelation, and that Jesus talks about in Matthew chapter 24 and 25. But that's not the case at all. And I'm going to tell you why it isn't. Follow closely. In verse 19, and he looked and said, look, I'm making known to you what shall happen in the latter time of the indignation. The latter time of the indignation. That was the latter time when Antiochus Epiphanes sacrificed the pig on the altar. That's called the indignation. The latter time of the reign of the Grecian Empire, and this indignation that took place in the relationship to the pig being sacrificed on the altar, and the sacrilegious act of that event. That was the latter time of the Grecian Empire, and it's called the indignation. Now, move on. There's a colon after that, and it says, then at the appointed time, the end shall be. So there's the indignation, and there's then the appointed time. That appointed time is when the Antichrist will do the exact same thing as Antiochus Epiphanes. And that will be the end. The other was the end of the Grecian Empire. Towards the end of that the indignation took place. The appointed time when the Antichrist does his thing will be at the end of the world, according to 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4. So it's important that we understand the sacrifice the Antiochus Epiphanes did was the indignation at the latter part of the Grecian Empire. It has nothing to do with the appointed time that God has appointed when the Antichrist will do the same scenario in Jerusalem when he is alive. So, the fact is, God is in control. The fact is that there's going to be two of these events that happen. One's already taken place. The other is still to come. One was at the latter time of the Grecian Empire. The other is at the end of the world. Daniel has so much to tell us. So much to tell us. And at the end of that chapter, he says, "And the vision of the evenings and mornings which was told is true. Therefore, seal up the vision," Gabriel says, "for it refers to many days in the future." That vision was sealed until Revelation. Now, regarding the time of 2,300 days, that's when that whole scenario was going to take place. Now, that's 7 years. We know there's going to be 7 years of tribulation. We know there's 3.5 years in the middle, or the first 3.5 and the last 3.5. And the last 3.5 are going to be different than the first 3.5. Remember when I told you in the last lesson there was two sacrifices? One in the morning and one in the evening. Both of those sacrifices were taken away. Which means that this 2,300 days are going to be cut in half. It'll make it 3.5 years that the sacrifice would be taken away, since there's two a day. We know that the Antichrist is going to come in, and in 3.5 years, he's going to make peace with Israel, peace with the world, and then after the end of that, everything is going to fall apart. And he comes in and does his thing, the scenario that Antiochus Epiphanes did. And once again, we see the sovereignty of God. The Antichrist, the unholy Trinity, believe they have conquered the world. But just as Cain killed Abel, God will raise a Seth. God will come back. Jesus will come back with the saints of the church, and the battle of Armageddon will be fought, and the Antichrist and Satan and the false prophet will be destroyed and cast in the lake of fire. God is sovereign. Don't ever forget it. The Bible is true. Everything that Daniel wrote happened and is going to happen, just as God communicated it to Daniel through the Archangel Gabriel. What's the application for us today? Be watching and waiting. God has something spectacular that's going to happen. Amen. And amen. God bless you.